If you've been given responsibility for managing chemicals and help reduce risk in your workplace, but you don't know your PPEs from your WELs, then hopefully this video will help you figure out which information you need to take from your safety data sheets to help you manage risk. If you are enjoying our content here in this format on YouTube, make sure to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel so we can let you know when we release more content. Also, as you're watching this video, there's probably a good chance that you're either involved or going to be involved in managing hazardous substances within your workplace. So I'm really intrigued to know what is it that you're actually managing. So if you can, take a moment to type into the comments box and let me know which hazardous substance is causing you most concern within the workplace environment. And from there, we'll get ready to crack on with looking at our safety data sheets. When we're looking for more information on the specific properties of a substance and ideas and guidance as to how to manage it, your safety data sheet is usually a good place to start. Hopefully, if the product is labeled correctly, you will be able to tell that there's reason to be cautious when using the material. Information on the label should include things like hazard symbols, which we covered in a previous video, which I'll link to here if you haven't seen it. Some short form information on the main health risks from using the hazardous substance, and as well as that, actually some ideas as to how you should use it and the first aid response measures as well. As you can imagine, because it is a product label, the information will be a short form version crunched down to fit onto the label, and it won't be as elaborate as the information that you will find within the safety data sheet itself. Okay, first and foremost, what is a safety data sheet? Well, if a product is classified as dangerous for supply, then the supplier themselves is obligated to produce a safety data sheet. Often referred to as SDS for short, the safety data sheet should then be made available to distributors and purchasers of the product as necessary. An SDS should provide extensive information on the product, its supplier, and information on safe handling and use of it. We can then use the information from the SDS to conduct chemical risk assessments in the workplace to help us manage and reduce the level of risk. If your product SDS is aligned with the Globally Harmonized System, or GHS, for classification and labeling, then it should contain a predefined set of sections with specific information. The 16 predetermined SDS sections are laid out as you can see on screen now. As you can see, there's a huge list of sections within the SDS itself, and we're not going to cover them all, but we will focus on the pertinent ones to make sure that you get all of the important health and safety information that you need. Now, let's go ahead and look at the type of information that we would expect to see within those safety data sheets, focusing on the parts that will help you manage health and safety in the workplace. Starting with the first section, which we'll cover very briefly. The first bit of information that you'll get here is the actual product name and its typical uses. It should also give you the names and contact details of the manufacturer or supplier of the product, which is also very helpful if you do need to contact them for any questions that you might have on the product or its use. Moving on then to our next section, hazard identification, where we start to put a bit more meat on the bones of managing health and safety of users and other people that may be affected with the use of this substance. Depending on the substance, the amount of information in this section can be a little overwhelming. But with that said, let's break it down into bite-sized, manageable pieces. First of all then, we have the classification of the substance or mixture, which relates to the categories of harm that have been assigned to the product. Let's continue with an example, and we're going to use that old trusty sodium hypochlorite, which is otherwise known as industrial bleach, to demonstrate what this classification means. The sodium hypochlorite has a number of classifications relating to harm both to people and to the environment. As the extract on screen shows, this substance is classified for skin corrosion, serious eye damage, and it's also classified as both a short-term and a long-term hazard to the aquatic environment. Picking out just one of these as an example, we can see that as it's classified for skin corrosion, it's been assigned the subcategory 1B. When a hazardous substance has been classified as a corrosive, it will also be ranked in terms of how corrosive it is, starting from 1A being the most corrosive substances, to 1B, 1C, and finally 2, which is for the least corrosive of those hazardous substances. Being in subclass 1B, this sodium hypochlorite product is in the more severe end or the higher end of the corrosive category scale. To give us an even better steer on the potential harmful effects of the substance, we can look towards another major element of this section, and that is the hazard statements. But before we move on and look at those, we mustn't forget our all-important hazard symbols or pictograms. You may have noticed in the image that our red diamond symbols have made an appearance. We have both the corrosive and the environmental hazard symbols here for our sodium hypochlorite. Hopefully the presence of these particular hazard symbols makes some sense considering the information that we've initially observed from our safety data sheet. The SDS hazard statements give us more specific insight into the potential harm that may be caused by a substance. For our sodium hypochlorite example, there are a couple of key hazard statements to sum up the risks. The first code we see here, as you can now see on screen, means that the substance causes severe skin burns and eye damage. As we discussed in our previous hazard symbols video, the harm from corrosive materials is likely to be irreversible or resulting in permanent damage. Secondly, with the next code, we can see the potential damage to the aquatic environment. This signifies that the solution is very toxic to aquatic life with long-lasting effects. Okay, those hazard statements give us some more context as to the types of risk presented by this substance. And that then brings our attention to the next part of the hazard identification section, and that is precautionary statements. It's one thing for us to know what the hazards and potential risks are, but we also need to know how can we avoid that harm being caused. In essence, the precautionary statements are a summary of how we should go about avoiding harm from the substance. This information is likely to be contained on the product label itself. It gives us a quick reference overview for what is needed, for example, for safe handling, in other words, PPE or personal protective equipment, and response protocols for different types of exposure, such as inhalation into the lungs or contact with the skin or the eyes. A quick glance at this section will let us know if we need significant amounts of PPE to handle the product. If you're worrying about where the specific guidance is on what PPE should be worn, don't panic, that comes along a bit later in section 8. Okay, slowly breathe out. That was the hazard identification section, and I realised it was a bit intense there with the amount of information, but hopefully that will set us up nicely to move through the rest of the sections that are important to us here for health and safety in the SDS. We're not going to go into detail here on the composition ingredients section because you don't really need to know the finer details of it. However, it is worth having a glance if you're making purchasing decisions, for example, to see the concentrations of the harmful agents within the product. The next part of the SDS that's really important for people that are managing health and safety is section 4, which is the first aid measures. The first part, section 4.1, is usually the main crux of the information that we need to look at, and that is the immediate response protocols that are recommended for different types of exposure, just as we mentioned before, that are outlined in the precautionary statements. Okay, that was a mouthful, but what does it actually mean? Well, let's continue with our industrial bleach example here. And if we think about the main entry routes into the body for a liquid solution like this, we will be thinking about things like contact with the eyes or skin, and also ingestion or swallowing. The first aid measures section should tell us what our appointed first responders should do in the event of an exposure. In this example, for skin contact, we're advised to rinse the skin thoroughly with water or a shower. This is really helpful information when we're considering the amenities that are available in the area that we're actually working, such as availability of running water. As you can hopefully see, it's really important to understand the first response protocols for the specific hazardous substance that you're dealing with. If we do take the wrong course of action or we don't have the correct amenities in place, we could end up making the situation worse, and of course we want to avoid that. The second subsection, 4.2, typically provides you with some further information on symptoms of exposure so that you can recognize when there is an issue. Section 4.3 then goes on to provide supplementary information that's really intended for medical practitioners, but it's worth keeping your eye on what's included in that as well. As a side note, if you find yourself in a scenario where the emergency response information isn't readily available, the best course of action is to just contact the emergency services and hopefully they'll be able to give you direct guidance. Okay, section 5 then is firefighting measures. So in this section, initially what we'd expect to find in the first part is information relating to extinguishing media or the tools that we would need to use to stop a fire at source and prevent it from spreading. In the case of our industrial bleach example, can you remember seeing anything that would indicate that the material is flammable? Okay, if you're thinking no, you are correct. There was no evidence from the hazard statements or any of the other supporting information to this point that this product was either flammable or explosive. Therefore, in the firefighting section here, there isn't too much of concern when it comes to the extinguishers. Our main concern for this product remains physical contact with it or hazardous gases that may arise in the event of a fire. As you can see from the example on screen, subsections 5.2, which relates to special hazards arising from the substance, and section 5.3, which relates to advice for firefighters. For this example, we see in these sections that it refers to hazards that may arise in the event of a fire, for example, producing harmful gases or vapors, and it provides us the recommendation that firefighters should wear self-contained breathing apparatus in the event of a fire. For our sodium hypochlorite, there's not too much to worry about when it comes to the selection of fire extinguishers, as it's not flammable or combustible in itself. However, if we were dealing with another very commonly used cleaning and disinfecting agent, such as ethanol, which is flammable, would we expect to see something different? We would have then expected to see, for example, the flammable hazard in the hazard symbol section, followed by specific advice on appropriate firefighting methods and extinguishing media. As you can see in the image, it's advised for this substance not to use a steady stream of water as it may spread the fire. Also, we can see that there may be further hazards that we need to consider, such as the production of explosive vapors and combustion byproducts like carbon monoxide. As a little tip, make sure to notify your local fire department in respect of what hazardous substances that you hold on your site, including quantities and locations. This will allow them to adequately prepare to launch a safe and effective response in the event of an emergency at your workplace. Section 6 covers advice measures in the event of an accidental release. In other words, it's spill or leak response. Most of the information that you'll find in this section is usually covered elsewhere in other sections, such as the environmental precautions or the PPE section, which we'll come to shortly. The part that we usually find the most uniquely useful in this section is the methods and materials for cleanup section. It's where we find the useful details on how we should responsibly and safely clean up a hazardous substance spill. As we already know with our industrial bleach example, it's very harmful potentially to the environment, so we need to prevent it from entering drains, watercourses, and the soil, for example, and also that it's corrosive, so we need to wear appropriate PPE if we're handling it. We can also see here that there's a note to ensure that there's adequate ventilation to avoid the inhalation of concentrated vapors. In addition, the cleanup measures in 6.3 advises us to use sand or other binding agent to absorb up the material before we can dispose of it properly. On that note, just a reminder that you will be able to find more information on disposal considerations in section 13, but we're not going to cover that in detail here. The next safety data sheet section then is handling and storage, and naturally that provides us with information on the safe handling and storing of the product. Again, section 7.1, precautions for safe handling, is often a bit of a rerun of previously covered information, but it's always worth taking a look to see if there's any additional guidance that you may need to know. Usually the most value in this section comes from the information related to storage. Section 7.2 lets us know how to store the material correctly and also helps us identify any potentially incompatible materials. In the case of our sodium hypochlorite example here, we can see information like the ideal storage temperature, the recommended storage conditions, and also, and importantly, the storage class of the product. For safety reasons, our hazardous products should be stored in accordance with the storage class that they've been assigned that's relevant to their hazard characteristics. It's also really important to note that whilst materials may belong to the same storage class, it doesn't always necessarily mean that they are compatible for storage. For example, we can see here that this one says do not store near acids. So for the sodium hypochlorite, although it's the same as sulfuric acid in terms of its storage class being 8B, these cannot be held together, otherwise we risk a chance of a severe and violent reaction. We're not going to go into detail on compatibility here, but it's just to acknowledge that there are certain substances and products that need to be kept apart depending on what hazard class they're in, and there's others that can be stored safely together. So just take that into consideration in your planning phase. And if you have enjoyed it and you found it valuable, I'd like to remind you once again, it really helps us if you can click the like button, and please drop us a comment and let us know what you found to be helpful, or if you have any other ideas on other content that you'd like to see us make just to help you with your understanding or your knowledge, then we'd love to hear it. So look, I appreciate you taking the time to watch our video. Make sure to subscribe to the channel, and we'll see you again soon.